While the team behind Z-Image Turbo have promised both an edit variant of the model and an in-painting control net, you can still get fairly good results in painting with just the Turbo model. Here's how. So this workflow is broken up into three different options. We're going to go over option one right now using only native nodes within Comfy UI. So to first start, we're going to click on this load image node, right click on it, and then open the mask editor. So we want to change the appearance of this character. So just simply click and highlight the area that you want to change to create the mask. You'll see that this now has two outputs. We have the original image output along with the mask. So the mask output will go first to this grow mask. So this will just expand the mask in every direction just slightly by 15 pixels. Then we convert it back to an image to blur it to soften the edges of that mask and then convert it back into a mask, resulting in an output that looks like this. So these, both the image and the mask, are then sent all the way to the InPaint model conditioning node. First, we'll give it a prompt. So we just want to have a woman smiling. Then it goes through the differential diffusion for the Z-Image Turbo model to help get softer results. And for the K-sampler, you can see that I have the recommended values for Z-Image Turbo. Now, the denoise value is adjusted downward slightly, so the model will know what's behind that mask a little bit to still preserve some of the original character's appearance. So let's process this workflow. All right, after just a few seconds, we have our output image. So here is a comparison. Here is our original character, and here is the in-painted character. We can see it. She takes on a much more realistic appearance without that shiny skin that's normally associated with AI images thanks to Z-Image Turbo. Option 2 is fairly similar to option 1, however, it's a little bit more compact. So we still have our masked image within the load image node, and we pass that mask over to this grow mask with blur custom node courtesy of Comfy UI KJ nodes. So you can see here that it expands the mask slightly and then also applies a slight blur to the mask. And then we can see what the resulting mask will look like thanks to the preview image node. Now, once that is set, we pass the mask and the image back over to this InPaint model conditioning, just like we did with the native nodes, and then click run. Everything else is still the same. We still have the same text prompt and the same denoise value for this image. So I expect fairly similar results. And after just a few seconds, we can see our resulting output image. Again, we can see she goes from a character with an AI sheen to her skin to one that is much more realistic thanks to InPainting. Option 3 is my favorite way to InPaint currently. So we reset this load image node to be just the original source image. And then we're going to pass this image into the segment anything 3 custom nodes. So you can find this on the Comfy UI manager. It's called Comfy UI -SAM3. So we are basically loading the model and then we are going to segment it by a simple text prompt. So in this case, I just simply put in the word face, and as you can see, it does a perfect bounding box of this subject's face. So I don't have to worry about any sort of manual masking. Once that has been masked and segmented, we send that into the InPaint Crop node. So this is also another custom node called Comfy UI InPaint Crop and Stitch. So we pass that image, original image, and mask to this node. And I made a few changes to the default settings. So first, I disabled this mask fill holes. The reason why is because sometimes whenever we use the Segment to Anything 3 model, it might collect, it's collecting more information and it's a little bit more precise, and it may inadvertently create some holes within that mask that we don't want to in-paint over. You can always toggle that on and off if you want. Secondly, I also changed the default width and height. So I upped this from 512 by 512 to 1024 by 1024. And as you can see, the resulting mask is very precise and also blurred thanks to these options within the middle of that node. Now, everything else is fairly the same. We're going to have still the same text prompt, but we're going to send this cropped image and cropped mask to the InPaint model conditioning node instead of just the raw mask or raw image that we originally loaded. We'll leave the K-sampler settings as they were and then pass the final image to this InPaint Stitch node. This will basically make sure that the image looks correct and is pasted together and then provide us with an output. So here's what our final output looks like. As we can see, it is much more precise. We can see even around her ear that it has now been inpainted, and then also too, the entire contours of the face are the exact same. Of course, we could manipulate this a little bit by increasing the blur if we wanted to change any of those at all in the final output. Lastly is the select object option within the segment anything nodes. So as you can see here, we have our same SAM3 model loaded, but instead of defining what it is that we want to inpaint with a prompt, we can actually select it on the image. So this might be good if you have a general area that you want to inpaint. So if we wanted to mask her face, we could just make a few selections here on the image. Now you can also give negative selections by just simply holding down the shift key and selecting other areas. I recommend only doing this though if the mask isn't working correctly. So if we process this mask by just simply clicking run, we'll see that it will go through this point segmentation and then provide a mask. So we can see it has selected now her face and neck area, and then it looks like there might be a point here on her fingertip that was also selected within the mask. We then send it to this InPaint crop node to crop it and then also blur the mask for slightly better results, pass it through the clip text encoder along with InPaint model conditioning, and then sample the image. So here's what that final output would look like. We can see that there is definitely some quality issues on this particular selection, so we might need to play with this a little bit more. And as far as with her finger selection, I'm not noticing too much in changes here within the pixels, although I would have to look at it a little bit closer at a full resolution. So that's it with inpainting with Z Image Turbo. If you have any questions, please drop a line in the comment section below. Thanks so much for watching, and I'll see you in the next one. Take care.